So hello and welcome guys, this is Ashutosh and this is the first class of basic electrical engineering. So let's start guys. So first of all we will study the classification of electrical networks. So guys, you can see over here the first definition is of linear network is a circuit or network whose parameters or elements like resistance, inductances and capacitances are always constant irrespective of the change in time, voltage, temperature, etc. is known as a linear network guys. And the Ohm's law can be applied to such networks. You can see over here in the second slide I will give the examples. Okay, so see the second definition, non-linear network, a circuit whose parameters change their values with change in time. You can see over here time, temperature, voltage, etc. is known as non-linear network, and the Ohm's law may not be applied to such networks. This is very important point. So what happens? Such network does not follow the law of superposition and the response of the various elements is not linear. This is very important point with respect to their excitation. And you can see in the second slide I have given some examples. You can see over here unilateral component or element, you can see here. Okay, unilateral element, conduction of current in one direction is termed as unilateral. Examples are diode, transistor and all the semiconducting devices. So guys, these are non-linear network. Okay, these are the examples of non-linear network. Like you can see over here the diode conducts in forward bias, it does not conduct current in reverse bias. As you can see over here, this is the forward bias and current will flow like this from left to right, but in reverse bias diode current cannot flow. Okay, and what is bilateral element? You can see from here bilateral elements, conduction of current in both directions in an element, example resistances, inductances and capacitances, also these are called linear components. Okay, with same magnitude is termed as bilateral elements. So you can see over here resistances, inductances and capacitances, okay, are termed as a bilateral element. So these are also called linear elements, as you can see over here in the first slide. Okay, linear, a circuit or network whose parameter or elements like resistances, inductances and capacitances are considered as a linear network. This is very very important point. So just moving on to third slide, as you can see from here, this is the VI characteristics shown over here. This is the VI characteristics of a resistor. You can see this is the first one. This is linear, almost linear. Okay, this is the inductance characteristics, then capacitance characteristics. Okay, so these are almost linear and practically there will be a tilt. Okay, in a bulb or when you perform VI characteristics of an incandescent bulb, then there will be some tilt in the VI graph. Okay, but almost it is a linear graph. And but you can see over here, this is the VI characteristics of triac or diac, and this is the VI characteristics of a practical diode, and this is the ideal diode. You can see over here, so these are non-linear VI characteristics. Okay, so moving on to the next slide. So guys, as you can see from here, what are the active elements? So a circuit, you can define a circuit which contains at least one source of energy is called active element, and an energy source may be a voltage source or current source. As you can see over here, this is the DC circuit, or it is also called active network because the DC voltage source is connected over here, okay, and DC current source is also connected over here in the circuit, as you can see. So what is the active element? Those elements which provide electrical energy to the elements like resistances, inductances, capacitances. Okay, so these are the source of EMF, and these provide electrical energy. That's why these are called active component. And what is the function of passive component or passive network? You can see from here, the passive network, a circuit which contains no energy source, is called passive elements like resistors. So guys, these are the elements which receive electrical energy, like these resistances consume electrical energy. These are the resistances, okay, and there is no energy source. Also from here you can see active elements, examples of active elements. You can see battery, generator, transistor, tunnel diode, triode, and semiconductor devices are also considered as active elements. And passive elements, the examples of passive elements are resistor, capacitor, inductor, transformer. Okay, so these are the basically passive elements. Okay, then moving on to the next slide. Okay, so see here, what is lumped network? So guys, a network in which all the network elements are physically separable is known as lumped network. Most of the electrical networks are lumped in nature, which consists element like resistor, inductor, capacitor, voltage source. So guys, if these are detachable from the circuit, okay, if a bulb can be detachable, inductor choke coil is connected in the circuit and you can detach it easily from the circuit, capacitor is connected, you can detach it from the circuit. So these will be called lumped parameter, lumped components. And distributed parameter, so guys, a network in which the circuit elements like resistance, inductance cannot be physically separable for analysis purposes is called distributed network. Okay, these are the components which are distributed along the transmission line. The best example you can see over here, the best example of such a network is a transmission line where resistances, inductances, capacitances are distributed along the transmission line, along its length, you can see over here, and cannot be shown as a separate elements anywhere in the circuit. So you can see over here, lumped circuit, resistor, capacitor, inductor, independent and dependent sources are lumped circuit elements. Okay, and these are physically separable. And distributed circuit, in a distributed circuit, for example, in a transmission line circuit, the size of the transmission line may be a considerable fraction of a wavelength, many wavelengths. Thus, a transmission line can't be modeled as a lumped circuit element. So it is distributed element, and it should be modeled as a distributed parameter network where voltages and currents are functions of positions as well as time. So as you can see over here, so guys, you have already seen the definition. These are the parameter: linear circuit, non-linear circuit. Then we will move ahead. And what is node, branch, loop and mesh? So guys, node is a junction in a circuit where two or more circuit elements are connected. We will see the example. Okay, what is branch? Branch is the part of a network which lies between two junctions. Loop is a closed path in a circuit in which no element or node is encountered more than once. And mesh, it is a loop that contains no other loop within it. So you can see from here, these are the examples. So guys, from here you can see, this is the DC circuit, and you can see here, these are the nodes. This is the node, because two or three branches are connected at this. This is the common point. Two or three branches are connected here. Okay, this is also node, and these are also node because two or more branches are connected over here. So this will be called node or a meeting point. And loop is any closed path in the circuit. Loop can contain another loop inside. Okay, but mesh cannot contain. This is a mesh. You can see this is a mesh, single mesh. Okay, so mesh cannot contain any loop within it. Okay, as you can see over here, a mesh is a loop which does not contain any other loop within it. So this is the term which will come, okay, the mesh analysis, okay, not the loop analysis. We will call it mesh analysis. So moving ahead. Okay, now comes the voltage source. So guys, ideal voltage source and practical voltage source, two types of voltage sources are there. So what happens? This is the ideal voltage source. Okay, the voltage source, okay, drawn like this. Okay, the voltage source is defined as the energy source which gives constant voltage across its terminals irrespective of the current drawn through its terminals. As you can see over here, this is the voltage source and this is the load. So source and load both are connected in the circuit. So it forms a circuit, and this is the symbol. You can see over here, this is the ideal DC voltage source. Plus minus electrodes are there. So if load is connected and it is drawing current from here, okay, it is drawing current from here. So even if the voltage of voltage source is maintained constant, as you can see over here, the voltage is constant, VSS is constant, it is not dropping, okay, even if the current is drawing from here, from the source. So this will be termed as ideal voltage source. And what will be the practical voltage source? When voltage drops, okay, the voltage is falling, you can see this is the practical voltage source. Okay, with the increase of current, load current, okay, there is a resistances connected. So this is the internal resistance. Okay, so here internal resistance is zero, and here there will be some internal resistance. So there will be a drop in voltage. So this will be called as a practical voltage source. So you can see over here, time-variant sources like AC, alternating sources, are called time-variant sources. The sources in which voltage is varying with the time are known as time-variant voltage sources or AC sources. And DC sources, the sources in which voltage is not varying with time, are known as time-invariant voltage sources or DC sources. So these are denoted by capital letters. Okay, so this is DC voltage source. Because the magnitude, okay, is constant, it is not changing with respect to time. Also direction is constant, but here in case of AC voltage source, the magnitude and direction both are changing with respect to time. Okay, so the same case with the current source, you can see from here, this is the DC current source. Okay, you can see over here, and load is connected, this is the load, and current is drawn from this current source. And even if the level of current is maintained, so it will be termed as ideal current source. And practical current source, so here there will be an internal resistance in parallel. Okay, so what is happening? The current is dropping from its level. Okay, so it is called practical current source. And time invariant, again, the sources in which current is not varying with time are known as time invariant. So the magnitude will be constant, direction will be constant. So these will be called DC sources, DC current source. Okay, this is currently, this is the DC current source. And time variant sources means AC sources. So the sources which are, okay, discussed above means the magnitude and directions are constantly changing with respect to time, continuously changing. So that will be considered as a time variant sources or AC sources. So dependent source, there will be a dependent source. So now you can see over here the dependent sources are diamond shaped. Okay, you notice over here. Okay, so first dependent source is called voltage dependent voltage source. This is the first dependent source. Okay, so it is the diamond shape. The shape is of diamond and it is depending upon some factor which is KV1. Okay, so it is depending upon voltage. So it will be called voltage dependent voltage source. It produces a voltage as a function of voltages elsewhere in the given circuit. So this is called VDVS. Second one you can see over here, current dependent current source. This is the current dependent current source. It is also of diamond shape. Okay, and the factor is depending upon KI1. So it will be called current dependent current source. Okay, third one is current dependent voltage source. Current dependent voltage, so this is the third one, okay, current dependent voltage source, and fourth one, voltage dependent current source. So these are the factors on which the values are dependent. Okay. Now you can see over here, what is Ohm's law? This is the question, okay, often asked in very interviews and viva. So basically guys, this is the conductor or resistor. This is the resistor and potential difference V is created across this. So what is the definition of Ohm's law? The current flowing through the electric circuit is directly proportional to the potential difference across the circuit and inversely proportional to the resistance of the circuit provided. Okay, and physical conditions are kept constant like temperature, pressure, etc. Okay, moisture. These will be constant. So mathematically you can say the current flowing in the conductor or resistor is directly proportional to applied potential difference or voltage V and inversely proportional to R. Okay, so you can say I equal to V upon R. Okay, I is proportional to V, so you can write I equal to V upon R. So it becomes V equal to IR. So guys, this is the Ohm's law. And DC circuit, you can see over here, the closed path followed by direct current is called DC circuit. In DC circuit, what are the different components connected? You can see over here, there will be a voltage source, DC voltage source, or it could be DC current source, and there will be a resistance, okay, pure resistance, no inductor, no capacitor in the DC circuit. So a bulb is connected, that is load, that is considered as a pure resistive load. And there are various examples of pure resistive loads like lamp, bulb, soldering iron, heater, immersion rod, etc. These are the examples of resistive loads. So guys, this is the source and this is the load and both are connected. And how many types of circuits, DC circuits are there? So you can see from here, there is a DC circuit, parallel circuit, series circuit, parallel circuit and series parallel circuit. So here you can see this is the series circuit where resistances are connected in this fashion. Okay, R1, R2 and R3 are connected in series. So this is the circuit in which several resistances are connected one after another, and such connection is also called end-to-end connection or cascade connection. And voltage is applied across the terminals. So current will be same in series circuit. You know the current will be same. We will see the difference between series and parallel circuit later. Okay. So now this is the parallel circuit. Now we can directly go to our next slide where the difference is shown. You can see over here. This is the series circuit. Okay. So series circuit will be the connection will be like this. R1, R2, R3, Rn. Okay. All the resistances are connected in series. And between two terminals, DC voltage is applied. Okay, you can see over here. And here in case of parallel circuit, all the resistances are connected in parallel. You can see over here, R1, R2, R up to Rn. Okay, so this is the parallel circuit. And what is the property of series circuit? The same current flows through, this is the second point. The same current flows through each resistance, but in parallel circuit, the same voltage will be applied. Voltage will be constant. But in series circuit, current will be constant, voltage is divided. Okay, and here in parallel circuit, current is divided. So the equivalent resistance you can see over here, third point and fourth point, you can see the fifth point, the equivalent resistance is the summation of all the resistances, R1 plus R2 plus dash 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 plus Rn up to Rn. And equivalent resistance in parallel circuit, R1 upon R equivalent equal to 1 upon R1 plus 1 upon R2 plus dash dash up to 1 upon Rn. So this will be the equivalent resistance in case of parallel circuit. So how can you find the equivalent circuit? So this is the example. Okay, you have to find out the equivalent resistance RAB. So here it is RAB. So between two points, this is the B point, this is the A point. Okay, how can you find the equivalent resistance? So so forget about this point. Okay, see, there is another point. So for finding, in order to find RAB, you have to forget about this point C. Okay, so now R2, see here, R2 and R3 are connected in series. Okay, so R2 plus R3, it becomes R2 plus R3, and these will be in parallel. So the answer will be R1, and the parallel combination of R1 and R2 plus R3. And guys, you can see the equivalent resistance across two points AC. So forget about this point B. ओके सो इसको आप भूल जाइए. ओके बी को आपको भूलना पड़ेगा एंड यू हैव टू फाइंड आउट द रेजिस्टेंस इक्विवेलेंट रेजिस्टेंस बिटवीन दीज टू पॉइंट. सो यहां पर क्या होगा गाइस, व्हाट हैपेंस, R1 और R2 जो है वो सीरीज कनेक्शन होगा. देयर विल बी दीज विल बी एडेड R1 प्लस R2 एंड इन पैरेलल विद द R3. So you can see over here the parallel combination between R3 and R1 plus R2 is the answer. Okay, and then the third example, RBC. So you forget about this point A. Okay, and now what happens? R1 plus R3 will be in series, and the equivalent resistance will be the parallel combination of R2 and R1 plus R3. Okay, so this is another example. You can see over here. Here you have to find out the equivalent resistance between points A and B. ओके सो बेसिकली क्या होगा गाइस, दिस इज द पॉइंट बी. ओके ड्रैग द पॉइंट बी लाइक दिस. ओके एंड स्ट्रेच ओके ए पॉइंट फ्रॉम हियर. सो हियर विल बी ए एंड हियर विल बी बी. ओके एंड नाउ व्हाट हैपेंस, 15 एंड 6 विल बी इन सीरीज. 15 ओम एंड 6 ओम विल बी इन सीरीज. हियर 10 ओम एंड 4 ओम विल बी इन सीरीज. ओके सो इट बिकम्स, okay, because this is the extra point, so it becomes 15 plus 6 21 and it becomes 10 plus 4 14, and now the parallel combination of 21 and 14 sorry 14. So it is the answer RAB, equivalent resistance 21 into 14 divided by 21 plus 14, 8.4 is the answer. Okay, so this is the another example you can see over here. Okay, here what happens, you have to find out the equivalent resistance, okay, between two points A and B, and C and D are the common points. So you can, what is the same potential, these are working on same potentials, so you can join C and D like this. Okay, this is the A point, stretch A point like this. Okay, this is A point, okay, upward direction, and stretch B in downward direction. This is the B, and C and D is the common point like this. C and D is the common point. And what happens between that? 15 and 10. Okay, see here. 15 and 6 are in this series combination. And 10 and the 4 is in series combination. But when you join C and D point, the 15 ohm and 10 ohm becomes in parallel. Okay, this will form parallel combination. And the another parallel combination between this 6 and 4. Now solve it, the parallel combination of 15 and 10. So 15 and 10 divided by 15 plus 10, it becomes this. Okay, and here you can solve 6 and 4 are in parallel, and then join. Okay, because this will form series combination, so this will be the answer. So another example, you can solve it. okay, you can just take a snapshot of it, okay, and you can find out by yourself, okay. So this is the answer. At last it is given, RAB, and this is your homework, okay. And this is the formula for voltage division. You can see over here, guys, this is the formula, direct formula of voltage division. When two branches are in series, like R1 and R2 resistances are connected over here in series, and voltage source V is connected. So how can you find out the V1 and V2? Okay, VR1, the voltage across. So between this, this is VR1, the voltage drop across. R1 is VR1, and the voltage drop across second branch is VR2. So you can directly find out VR1 equal to the total voltage. This is the formula, total voltage. Okay, put the voltage here into same resistance in which you are finding, okay, across which you are finding, okay, the voltage drop, R1 upon R1 plus 2, R1 plus R2, the summation of total resistance, okay. And VR2, the total voltage V, then R2 in which, okay, or across which you are finding out the voltage drop, divided by the summation of both the resistances R1 plus R2. So it is called voltage divider circuit, okay. And then next is, this is the example how voltage is divided. You can take the snapshot from it, okay. So here 10 ohm, 20 ohm and 30 ohm resistances are connected in series, and 60 volt voltage source is connected. So what you have to do, just apply the formula of voltage division, put the value total voltage 60 into 10 divided by total resistance R1 plus R2 plus R3. So it is the answer, VR2, total voltage 60 into R2, the value of R2 is 20, divided by R1 plus R2 plus R3. Okay, the answer is 20. And VR3, total voltage V, R3 is 30, divided by R1 plus R2 plus R3, then it becomes 30 volt. Okay, so this is the voltage division. And guys, this is the current division circuit. So this is the parallel circuit where current is divided. Okay, so you can see the total current is I, IT. And this is the first branch, R1 is connected in this branch. And our second branch is R2 is connected in this branch. So this is the first branch, and in this branch current I1 is entering. This is the I1 current, and in this branch current I2 is entering, because current is divided from here, from this node. The total current is coming in this node, and two branches are there. So the current will be divided into two parts. So guys, if you have to find out the value of I1, means current in this branch. So write this formula, the total current will be there, IT, into the front resistance R2 should be there, okay, because I and R are inversely proportional. That's why you are finding out the current in this branch, R1 branch, but you have to write the front resistance first, R2 divided by the summation of total resistance, R1 plus R2. So this will be I1, and I2 is equal to total current IT into R1, the front resistance comes first, divided by R1 plus R2. So guys, this will be the answer. And this is the numerical, you can solve it, okay, by yourself. You can just take the, okay, note it down, the draw the circuit and solve it, try to solve it. So guys, that's it for today, okay. This is our first class of basic electrical engineering, and then this is also called a revision class, because you must have studied, okay, these all the fundamentals in your 12th class, okay, in the topic of electricity, okay, in the chapter of electricity, okay. So then from here, okay, after this topic, the main topic will be started, okay. So guys, goodbye.